Can you see presentation slides on the your screen? Good. Thank you. All right. So probably it will be worth to recall the stuff which is started last week. So we consider it a linear representation of a group as a useful tool to study property of this group on one side, and on the other hand, it also help clarify and study properties of vector spaces where our representation act on. And it's worth to consider back the examples, rather basic one, but still representative, which was introduced where we will illustrate certain important concept today based on this example. So a group of real numbers with addition. So clearly there is one-dimensional unitary representation by characters, one-dimensional multiplication by unimodular complex numbers associated to this real. And this is example one. Then there is example two, where our group act by a shift in L2 spaces on square integrable functions. This is again unitary representation. The norm of function is not changed because Lebesgue norm is invariant under shift. And the more general case, we simply generalize that second example for any group G, commutative or non-commutative, as soon as we are able to find an invariant measure on this group, and this is always possible in essentially unique way, then we may introduce left and right regular representation by shifts, either a multiplying argument of function by group element from the left or from the right. So that will produce unitary representation of our group. So second example is just particular case of third example for the group of reals and addition. And we said that for study of representation, we use the standard technique decomposition. We are looking for invariant subspaces which are not alterated by group action, and then consider representation restricted to these invariant subspaces. That will be sub-representation. And as soon as we are not able to find such invariant subspaces, representation would called irreducible. And otherwise, if there are invariant subspaces, it's reducible. And coming back to previous example of the reals with addition, we may see what, of course, one-dimensional representation by characters is irreducible. This is always irreducible representation, simply for one-dimensional space, a non-trivial subspace shell. Well, there are no non-trivial subspaces. It's either entire one-dimensional subspace or zero vector. So characters always produce irreducible representation. So first example for real is irreducible one. But if we are dealing with the spaces of functions which square integrable on the real line and consider action of reals by shift, second example, then we see what vera exists. Invariant subspaces. For example, the Hardy subspace, the Hardy space, a space of functions which admit analytical extension to the upper half plane and respectively orthogonal complement to it, functions which admit orthogonal expansion into a lower half plane, clearly they are invariant under shifts. So if we shift a function, when invariant, when analytical extension to the upper half plane still exists, it also will be shifted. But Hardy subspace being invariant, so we may consider restriction of our representation to the Hardy space, it's not irreducible itself. So inside Hardy subspace, we still may find invariant, small invariant subspaces. For example, it may be related to certain spaces of orthogonal polynomials, finite dimensional vector spaces in Hardy space, and that polynomials under shift will still produce polynomials, so we still have that type of reducibility. And here the general rule will be, ideal situation will be, if we have an invariant subspace and its orthogonal complement being invariant, then we can split initial vector space V into the direct sum of invariant subspace V. Okay, so there is misprint here. I noticed it just now. So it will be a direct sum of V1 and V2, where both V1 and V2 are invariant. This is ideal situation, which not always happen. It may occur a situation where invariant subspace V1 is invariant, but its complement, something which make a direct sum, is not invariant. That is possible, and that makes situation even more untractable. So coming back to, well, and ideally we continue such a decomposition into direct sum until we came to the sum of irreducible components. Then for irreducible components, the representation shall take the simplest possible form, and any other representation would be the direct sum of these irreducible components. However, again, picture is not so simple, even for simple groups. If we consider a group of reals and shifts of L2 function on reals, then invariant subspaces may not be splitted into such discrete sum. You see that we need to consider continuous sum, integrals of irreducible components. And decomposition into such irreducible components will be effectively provided by Fourier transform. So we will do the Fourier transform, and then shift by Fourier transform will be mapped to the multiplication by characters. So we split our function into a direct integral of one-dimensional irreducible subspaces with simplest possible representation. This is how situation happen even in simple case, and that essentially will be repeated, as we will see later in details, for the Heisenberg group. In general, a representation for the Heisenberg group may be decomposed into integral of irreducible components parameterized by certain real numbers. So we will investigate it carefully later. Now, that was a background on representations, and question is, having a particular group, how we may build a sufficient supply of its representations, what technique can be used to it. And one of the most efficient tools probably is so-called induced representation, induced in the sense of George Mackey, who proposed or single out that construction. Very often it's just called induced representation. Some people say induced representation in the sense of Mackey, so this is the same thing. The situation will be as follow. So typically we have again a group, and we have a certain subgroup H, and subgroup H being a smaller, simpler object, probably easier to start with, and we may be able to know certain maybe unitary, maybe even irreducible representation for subgroup H. Now question is, are we able to expand that representation in non-trivial way to entire group G? So is it possible to make such an expansion from a closed subgroup? And that construction exists. So what we will do is this type of representation, expansion, we will describe them in two different realization. Essentially, we will speak about induction from a character when representation of subgroup H is one-dimensional, if it's just complex valued character. It's not a strict mathematical statement, it's just empirical fact that almost all representation which we know is induced by a character. So it's possible if we just or construction, mathematical construction, allow us make induction from any representation. For practical needs, we effectively need only induction from character. So maybe in the following, in particular what happened for the Heisenberg group, so in the following, to simplify things, you may think about chi here being a one-dimensional character rather than a general representation of the group. It's simplify a little bit formulas and simplify a little bit calculations, because if chi is a representation, even finite dimensional, when it's an operator and when you need to put it on the left from the object which this operator act on, so you need to take certain care when you prepare your formulas. But if it's a character, it's just a complex number. When you can multiply by complex number from either side, you can put it anywhere in your formula. It's not an operator anymore. Well, in general sense, it's not an operator. It's just a number. So the formulas became easy to manipulate. So assume we have chi to be a character. Then let us consider the space of functions on the group G, which has such a property. So for any element H of the subgroup H, we have this covariance property. Shift from the right by element H reduced to the multiplication of value of function by this character. So what happened here effectively, as I imagine it's for myself. So function is a map from domain, which I think horizontally, to the range, something which I think vertically. So that space of function has the property what certain transformation of the horizontal domain just may be replaced by simple operator, operator of multiplication in the range. So somehow it's connect so it connects certain properties in the domain with a certain property in the range. So your function is not arbitrary anymore. It's satisfied to that covariant property. It's very easy to see by the nature of that formula. What if I apply to this function the left shift? Then that property will be preserved. Because if I multiply here argument of function from the left here, then multiplication by H from the right is not affected. So after left shift, that property of function is preserved. That means I have that property preserved by left shift. So the space, vector space of function with this property will be invariant under left shift. So that helped me to consider just a certain invariant subspace of function, define it on entire group. When I may take my left regular representation, representation by left shift, and consider the restriction of this left regular representation to that invariant subspace. What result is called as induced representation. So this is the first realization. Well, conceptually it's not difficult, but if you just follow, it's just a couple of lines to describe that representation. But again, I recall what almost all interesting representations of Lie groups which we know may be obtained from that simple consideration. There is a second realization of this construction, induced representation, which allow us to realize our function somehow on the smaller space. Because covariance property told you that function shall be transformed by the shift with H from the right in some specific particular way. So that means what your function is not completely arbitrary, it has certain inner constraints. And you may just reduce the dimensionality of the domain, throwing away that constraint or using away that constraint. And that is done by the map which called lifting. So because I have invariance, that covariance property for function with respect to action of subgroup H, it's naturally to associate to function with this property functions on the homogeneous space, G over H. So having a function F small defined on the homogeneous space, I can lift it to entire function, to function on entire group G with the covariance property. In fact, what I need to do, taking a general element G on my group, I project G to the homogeneous space, so I pick up corresponding equivalence class with respect to equivalence relation, as we discussed for homogeneous spaces. I pick up equivalence class P of G and substitute it to the F small. And there is a reminder. So when I split my elements, or I, when I project my element G to corresponding equivalence class, all elements in the equivalence class are mapped to the single object representative of this equivalence class. And at this point, I may have a reminder, or I will have a reminder. This is a difference between element G and representative of equivalence class for G. So that reminder will be denoted by H, or by the end of slides, I introduce explicit formula. It will be, again, defined as a certain function R map of G. So that R of G creates the reminder element of the subgroup H, which is necessary for me to keep the information, the entire information about element G. So element G has a unique representation. So element G has the unique representation as such a product. This is the product. Sx, where x is projection of G to the equivalence class, Sx is element in the group which representing that equivalence class, times H, element from the subgroup. So, and what, how my function is built, the X, that projection of G, is put into the domain of function as argument, its domain of function, and element H contribute to the value of function, act in the range by multiplication with character chi of H. This is how we do. So we split our group, a portion of element on the group contribute to the value in the domain argument, and then a reminder from the subgroup H affect the value of function range. So having such a representation, I build function with covariance property. It's easy to check what this function automatically have the covariance property, which is on the first displayed formula on this slide. So I can make the left shift of such function, resulting again to the function with this covariance property. And then clearly from a function from this space, by the map, which is we can call pooling, it will be just opposite map to the lifting, we can transfer our function back to the homogeneous space, so the function define it on the homogeneous spaces. So here is again handful the diagram which we used before to define action of our group on the homogeneous space. So for this portion, problem to select some part of text here. No, it's not select group. So again, if formula, resulting formula on the homogeneous space using pooling, lifting, and that covariance property will be written on, so we will get that expression. So it's maybe not looking as simple as the first definition of induced representation, but it's equivalent to this one. And now an advantage of that form for induced representation, what we are considering more or less any arbitrary function on our homogeneous space. On the group, it was function only with this covariant property, but on the homogeneous space, almost any function can be considered. So that excessive redundancy here of values and arguments disappear. So that representation has also a certain advantage. Again, it's a bit about general construction of induced representation. For purpose of this course, we are interested for particular realization for the Heisenberg group, and that will be written explicitly later. So it will be just good to understand the root of these formulas to see how they can be obtained in for the Heisenberg group and maybe for other group from the scratch. So coming back to these examples, so we already considered subgroups of the Heisenberg group. In particular, we know what one-dimensional subgroup of the Heisenberg group is its center, Z, or a subgroup which we denoted HX, which contain X on the second place and zero otherwise. So if I will use previous formulas, well, this is one-dimensional subgroup. For one-dimensional subgroup, which isomorphic to the group of real, its character known, so it's just as before for reals. Any number H bar, somehow very strange selection is working here. So sometimes it's not possible to select just a part of formula which I want. So any parameter H bar, which I am interested in, so it's a real number, generate a character of one-dimensional subgroup in first case and in the second case. So any real number generates such a character, a complex, a unimodular complex number associated to elements of the subgroup. And using that character, we may just produce induced representation according to the above formulas. So that formulas represented on the screen. So just look what happened, what is the structure of this formula. Again, difficult to select a part which I want here. if you remember, when we look on the corresponding homogeneous spaces and factorize subgroup Heisenberg group by its center, the remaining homogeneous space can be parameterized by the plane, two-dimensional Euclidean space with coordinates X and Y, and Heisenberg group act on this homogeneous space by shifts. This is exactly what we see in the argument on our function. Value SXY, as the element of the Heisenberg group, act on the domain as usual Euclidean shift, commutative shift. So that became not very interesting or exciting, but when we consider just homogeneous space. But when we turn to the linear representation and put a character which take account of this reminder inside of subgroup, when we have in front of function the factor based on this character, and that factor take account of non-commutative nature of the Heisenberg group. The symplectic form omega appears in that character, and so action of Heisenberg group, non-commutative action of the Heisenberg group, simply make trace in this formula. And similar, again, formula appears in the second case. Again, non-commutativity here of the group presented in this term, which is, again, a trace of the symplectic form. For the two-dimensional subgroup, which we identified before, we may, again, calculate the map R from the Heisenberg group to that subgroup. So there is a formula here, and we may pick up a character of this two-dimensional subgroup, its commutative subgroup. Again, any irreducible representation is one-dimensional, so it's a character of this type. It's parameterized by h bar and further real number q. Then result of calculation of induced representation will be as follow. Functions are now defined on the homogeneous space, which is real line. We factorize three-dimensional Heisenberg group by two-dimensional subgroup. So homogeneous space is one-dimensional. And the value of function is multiplied by the character from the remainder. Well, that formula is very well known for a special case, q equal to zero. As we may show, for different characters, representation which appears became oftenly equivalent. We can intertwine them one with another, and one of the canonical way to make intertwining map here is to put q equal to zero in that representation. If q equal to zero, the representation which we obtain is known as Schrödinger representation, one of the first representation used for quantum mechanics when we are modeling a particle on the real line, quantum particle on the real line. Need that particular action of the Heisenberg group, as we will consider later. So, again, we really, on these two last slides, based on different subgroup, built quite a lot of representations, essentially three different type of them, and each representation have certain number of parameters. So it looks like we may have quite a lot of different representation for the Heisenberg group, but we remember what representation may just look, appear to be different, but essentially mathematically they will be equivalent if there is an intertwining operator between them. So that is the formula of intertwining property for representation. We say two representation rho and rho dash are equivalent or unitary equivalent if there is a unitary operator which intertwine them. Intertwine means that identity. So it's mapped from one space to another, and we effectively mean made pass from one representation to another by means of that invertible unitary operator. And we will see what for the Heisenberg group, just value of parameter h bar alone, which has physical meaning of Planck constant, completely define our representation, completely tell us which equivalent unitary equivalent class it belongs to. When we have representations of a certain group, it's worth to consider not each representation separately from others. Rather, it's helpful, as it's oftenly, as it's common in mathematics, to consider all representation together and equip the collection of representation all representation by certain additional mathematical structure. For example, it may be topology. We may say what certain representation are closed one to another, or we may say what certain representation are limiting case of another representation. So we need the space of all or set of all representation to be considered as a certain set with additional structure. And again, there is a rather natural way to associate such a structure to collection of representation. That is known as orbit method of Kirillov. Kirillov introduced that method initially to classify all unitary representations of nilpotently group. And it was a problem which completely solved by the orbit method. So in term of orbits, all properties, interesting, important properties of unitary representation of nilpotent group have been described. For other groups, that method work not so well. but we will not touch it because the Heisenberg group is the simplest case of nilpotently group, and we may simply be interested in that particular case where orbit method is most powerful, most efficient, and completely suits all our properties. So let's briefly outline how that orbit method working in general. We start in quite general term, then specify it again for the Heisenberg group. And we again start from quite general Lie group and recall what according to general theorem, such a Lie group may be thought as subgroup of GL2 in certain n-dimensional vector space. GLN in certain n-dimensional space. And so it may be realized by matrices, it's called matrix group. So we even take a Lie algebra of the corresponding of this group and consider adjoint action by conjugation, which work as a simple inner automorphism. This is such a map of the Lie algebra. Clearly, see if we apply that conjugation to the group, conjugate on the group. On commutative group, it's just a trivial map. And on any other group, this is a map which fixes the group identity. So unit is passed to the unit on the group by that conjugation. So tangent space on at the unit is transformed to the tangent space at the unit. But tangent space on the unit is a model for Lie algebra of a Lie group. So that generates certain transformation on the corresponding Lie algebra. Then we may call that representation where we have the transformation of corresponding Lie algebra as adjoint representation of the group G. This is a standard name. Well, construction itself may be not very direct. We try, we build certain Lie algebra, tangent vector space, other things, so we need to take derived representation. Fortunately, for the matrix group, there is a simple direct formula. When we have a matrix form, both elements of the group and both elements of the Lie algebra are representable by matrices of certain type. And when we pick up a matrix B, which represent an element of Lie algebra, and a matrix G, which represent element of the group, when adjoint representation described above in rather general terms, simplified to very straightforward formula. We do just matrix conjugation of B by G. So we do usual matrix conjugation. So all the above slide, that complete slide may be simply summarized for matrix group in this simple formula. When we are passing to the dual space, so you know, Lie algebra is a vector space, so there are linear functionals, unbounded linear functionals on that vector space, and they form a vector space itself. Whenever you have an operator on the vector space, you may consider an adjoint operator. And so we will be interested rather not in adjoint representation of group on its Lie algebra, we will be rather interested in coadjoint representation when we are taking adjoint operators and take action on the dual to the Lie algebra, on the space dual to the Lie algebra. Again, for matrix group, that general construction may be simplified as follows. There is the standard inner product on the matrix spaces, which is invariant under adjoining of elements. It's given by the trace of product A times B. So that is bilinear form on matrices, which is invariant under conjugation. So we may pick up the orthogonal complement to the matrices which represents the Lie algebra, And when the quotient space of all matrices over our vector space over that orthogonal complement, that will be the model for the dual space. It will be all if we factorize to by vectors which orthogonal to the our space, the remaining vector will represent classes which are act as linear functional through the wet pairing, through wet bilinear form. So that will be canonical model for the dual space. And so having the wet factor space, there is a natural projection P from the all matrices to wet dual space to the Lie algebra. And then coadjoint representation, based on previous discussion, we need to just take projection P of the adjoining action on matrices. So matrix form, for the matrix form, with coadjoint representation, again, take very simple direct expression. So let's, again, it was before the general theory, we may just see how it's work for the Heisenberg group. So element of the Heisenberg group, where it was exercises which we did before. Actually, in this course, I tried to avoid some excessive information. And if at some point you are told to check property, like our group is isomorphic to certain matrix group or something like that, that is oftenly done for a purpose. And as well you see in this example, that matrix presentation which you met on our first lecture on the Heisenberg group now will help us to derive representation of the Heisenberg group. So we have G, which represent the matrix, 3 times 3 matrix, which represent element of the Heisenberg group. We have matrix B, which represent element from the Lie algebra. Again, we have an exercise to check what Lie algebra element are representable in this form. When that matrix conjugation easily can be calculated, it's given by that matrix on the second displayed formula. And then we may write down the transformation on the dual space. So passage from that operator to its adjoint give us so that matrix act on the vector space according to this expression. Can I select it? So we have as linear operator our representation act by this formula. When adjoint operator, it's just transposed matrix. So acting by transpose matrix produce such a transformation on the space of vector functionals on Lie algebra. It's coadjoint representation. So we may see at this point that elements of the dual space, which has Planck constant h equal to 0, they are fixed points. So if h equal to 0, when the transformation leave point invariant, for h non-equal to 0, there is orbits which appear in that case. So following diagram illustrate the situation. So a collection of all linear functional to Weyl algebra is a three-dimensional vector space. Weyl algebra itself is three-dimensional space. Dual space will be three-dimensional as well. We parameterize elements of this dual space by P, Q, and H. When there are essentially two different situations, either H equal to 0, so this is a hub, a plane which split three-dimensional space into three cases here. So H equal to 0. In this case, every point of that plane H equal to 0 make an orbit itself. It's fixed point, so fixed point is an orbit itself. For H not equal to 0, if we will act by previous, again, by this selected formula here, as you can see, by action of the Heisenberg group, value of H is not affected. So all that horizontal hyperplane with H is different from zero, they are fixed, they are orbits, so we may transitively act on entire plane with fixed value H different from zero, and these points correspond, these orbits, planes, correspond to single infinite dimensional representation. So H equal to zero give us characters, one-dimensional representation, there are infinitely many of them, parameterized by points of the plane, and there are infinitely many infinite dimensional representation parameterized by non-zero value of H. So on that diagram, we collapse any orbit to a single point. So entire hyperplane are collapsed to the points of this vertical line, and the points of the horizontal plane H equal to zero remain representation themselves. That is a structure which actually described a topology which we have on the dual space, on the space of all representations. So when H tends to zero, in a sense, we have the limiting case. When H tends to zero, that infinite dimensional representation simply dissolve into one-dimensional characters. We will discuss it in connection with quantum and classical mechanics and correspondence principle between quantum and classical mechanics, that the relation between different representations. Well, maybe I was just a bit fast, but I think it will be properly a proper place to stop a lecture today about representation. We will start to speak about physics and mechanics on the based on Heisenberg group on the next week. Have you got any questions? Okay, thank you. Hope to see you next week.